remain standing. I'm going to give a word of invocation and prayer, and then you can be seated. Thank you. Father, we thank you for this lovely day that you've given us, which pales in comparison to where our brother is today and your presence. We ask that everything that's done today would be glorifying to you, that would be eulogizing our dear brother Dick, as he made a great impact on all of our lives because of his commitment to you in Christ. So we just ask that everybody would have a calmness today that's going to speak, and that everything would be pleasing in your sight. And we pray these things in Christ's name. We're going to go along with the programs that he handed out to you, pretty much. But as you can see there, that the family has prepared a video of the life of Dick Whitcomb and his family. Didn't really have enough room for all that, but that's what we're going to look at now. So.
You're my peace of mind. Your love is a pearl. You're my Mona Lisa. You're my rainbow skies. And my only prayer is that you realize your love is beautiful. And the seasons will change, and all the lessons we will learn will be beautiful and strange.
Thank you.
Love!
very well done. And Papa D. At this time, we'd like to go ahead and, if you would rise with me, we're going to have some congregational singing. It's called, we'll pick out. It's called In Christ Alone, and you will find it as the first song inside the bulletin.
Hello. Objects of Divine Love. This is a saying of C.S. Lewis, a writing of C.S. Lewis. We were made not primarily that we may love God, though we were made for that too. But God may love, we were made that God would love us, that we may be the objects in which His divine love may rest. That has blessed me so much to think that God made me, God made you, so that His divine love would rest upon you. Dick, God's all that's in the universe. It's all around. And we have to accept it. We have to accept His love for us. And I know it pains Him when we don't, because He created us to love us. And if we don't allow that, Dick was an example of love, and he came to accept that love when he was 18 years old, and our lives changed. He was the epitome of love that wouldn't change, no matter what. And that's how God loves us, no matter what. His love flowed out to family, friends, and I had the privilege of knowing that love and knowing that man for over 53 years. He's loved me through times of trouble, through times of pain, things that would normally throw a couple apart. But His love held us together. He showed love, not necessarily by words, because he didn't talk a lot, but He showed love through His actions. And I've heard that men only listen to women for 6 minutes. So for 6 minutes, maybe he listened and then it all went. So I had a gentle spirit, very gentle spirit, more than anybody that I know. He said he was perfect. So. And we had an incident when he was teaching 2 and 3 year olds in our church, and the one child would go home and he says, "Mommy, Jesus did this, Jesus did that." And she was saying, "Oh my, she's practicing the presence of Christ." And she'd go with all the tales. Well, when we went to their house for a baptism in their pond, she said, "Jesus is here, Jesus is here." Dick was wearing mutton chops and a beard and a mustache. So they wanted to check exactly what Dick was teaching those kids. But it's the closest thing to Jesus. It's not perfect, but he was really close. So, we went fishing with our kids when we were camping. And fishing with 4 children was no easy task, because they got their line stuck, they needed bait put on, but he was always patient. He didn't get too relaxed when he was fishing. our camping camping trips. We love to camp, and we camp with our family now. Four generations camp, which is a blessing. We camp with us, and he makes ready-to-order omelets, which take probably 2 hours to do. He makes one at a time, and at the request of what they want in it. So, Mike, you may have to take over that. So.
It's not a bad day.
God's love flowed out from him to others, to people he met, to friends, to our family, and to me, for which words could not express what that means. And I just want to thank you all for your support and for your love, your kind words. Thank you.
I was overwhelmed yesterday by the outpouring of people. The love that they said. It seemed like everyone had a script that they were given when they came in the door about how selfless he was, how he always did whatever they needed, all the people at work said he was always friendly and happy, and whatever they needed him to do, he would do. And it, everyone said it, so it was pretty neat to see, because we know that, but it's neat to see everyone around him that agreed and said the same things. I had the privilege of spending a lot of time with him when he was sick. I was able to take him to the doctors, sit through chemo with him. So I'm just very thankful for that time that we had, him and I and Mom and sometimes our sisters. So I just thank him for that. And on his last night, it was about 2 or 3 in the morning, and everyone had settled down. He was sitting in his recliner, and everyone had laid down, and him and I had 2 hours of, he didn't talk, he didn't respond much, but just him and I in the quiet of the house, and I'll always treasure that time with him. He was a great dad, and I'm thankful for the godly example that he showed to us.
I'm going to try to not ad-lib as much as possible because I have this written down. We'll see. I realized most of the things I want to say today are ones everyone who knew my dad would say or already knew, so I thought I would share a few things that were special to about him to me personally. So the emotional, overly sentimental daughter that I am, a quality I like to think I got that from my dad. I think where we differed is my dad wasn't as outspoken about his feelings like I am. If you read my Facebook posts, you know. But in private conversations when no one else around, he and I would talk, and I realized that he and I were very much the same. And it never failed that any time we watched Dirty Dancing, and we watched it a lot, my dad and I were keeping track, and I think we lost after the 300th viewing. It didn't matter if it was the first time or the last time we watched it. There were always certain scenes that would cause a tear of joy or two. There were certain scenes when we would watch it, we'd look over at each other and notice the other one was getting a little misty and we'd start giggling. And then there's the final dance scene. We'd watch it and then rewind it over and over and over again, and it seemed like we never got tired of it. I'm so thankful that God gave me the chance to watch it with him one last time not too long ago, and pretty much everything that happened all the other times when we watched it happened that time as well. My dad not only did humans love my dad, but animals did as well. That is the animal whisperer. And I could tell you stories about monkeys and different things in the dogs, but I'll skip that. It goes back to how my dad and I were kind of the same after I had to put my Rottweiler to sleep. Our first camp trip was coming up. It was Memorial Day, and I had my dog's ashes in the can. And my dad was over the Wednesday before, and he asked me if I was pretty enamored with us. So I did. And when everyone else went to bed, it was just my dad and I sitting around the campfire. He gave me the look like, it's time. So I got the dog's ashes and sat in between us, and we sat around the campfire. My dad understood my sentimental ways because he shared them as well. That was my parents' house for a couple years ago, and as most of you know, or all of you know, they lost pretty much everything and escaped with the clothes on their back. My dad wearing his white beater, if you've seen the video, but thank goodness an angel was watching over them. We had a red eagle that hung on the wall, and I remember this eagle growing up. He swore it was in the house. We looked and looked and looked, and now my mom will argue that he threw it away years ago, but my dad insisted it was somewhere in the house. We sifted through the ashes and the rubble, ruins, whatever, so many times, and each time my dad would give me a look and say, this is the last time. Only we'd go out and do it all over again a day afterward. On a side note, we never did find the eagle, but how ironic was it that I found out just a couple days ago that I'll Fly Away was his favorite song. It's because of my dad that I've been reunited with the Whitcomb side of my family, knowing in my heart that last summer would be probably the last summer we would be camping, and knowing that my dad got together with his brothers and their friends at McDonald's for coffee when we camped in Streetsboro, I decided I would join him. I affectionately called, and will call, the coffee club, the grumpy old men's club on steroids. But it's a trip. You have to experience because oh my gosh, I'm so glad that I did that because, and I'm still doing that, and you come down the streets for, oh, you bet, we'll be there. I felt so blessed that I did that, not only because I got to know my uncles and my cousins again. We finally organized a family reunion last fall that was 15 years in the making. Knowing how much that meant to him, I promised him that reunions will continue. I could go on and on why my dad is so special to me, but I will mention two more things. Well, there might be three. I might have added one, but one was the fact I got to live with my parents, not once, not twice, but three times because of life circumstances. I also got to have not only one, but two father-daughter dances. And more was the fact that we were both diagnosed with cancer within 3 months of each other. He was with me at every surgery, and I will never forget the prayers he said each and every time before they wheeled me away. I, in turn, spent as much time as I could with him in his final months of life. No matter how bad things were or seemed to be, he just keeps swimming. I will always cherish his last months that I got to spend with my dad, whether it was driving through my parents' old neighborhood with them, seeing the houses they grew up in, and hearing the stories of their youth, tooling around in Chesterland with my dad reminiscing about our life there, or simply sitting on the couch watching the snow fall. Many of you know, or you guys know, that we call my dad Papa D. Well, he got that name from my son Kelly. This is the third time I lived with them. Kelly was two or three or whatever. He was very inquisitive about what people's jobs were. Remember, he asked Mike if he wanted to know what he did, and was fascinated and learned he was a salesman. And he asked my dad. My dad said he was an inspector. Well, at that time, Inspector Gadget was popular, so he started calling him Inspector D, and then somehow it transitioned into Papa D. And therefore, he will always be Papa D. If I had to sum up my dad in three words, they would be loved like crazy. He loved his wife, his family, his friends, his God, his church, and even strangers. Well, he loved golfing and camping too, but. I said three words. I'm trying to keep this brief, although I didn't do a very good job. Love Like Crazy is one of the songs I chose to use for their 50th wedding anniversary, and then this song is used today. And it perfectly depicts them, my dad. And my mom, too. My parents truly held up the vows, for better for worse, in sickness and in health, and in death, until death do us part. There will never be, my life will never be the same. And I miss my dad more than I could have ever expressed. I've had the time of my life, Papa D, and I owe it all to you until we meet again.
Thank you, everybody, for coming today. It's nice to see that, you know, my grandpa, our grandfather, father, uncle, that he meant this much to all of you. And during all of this, I've had a few heavy memories to think of that have kind of helped me through it. And, one of them was when I lived with them. Saturday mornings, we would watch cartoons on his recliner in our robes. And I remember watching Scooby-Doo and, you know, all the cartoons, all the good cartoons that were out.
Amen.
I also remember one time, sorry Grandma, if this embarrasses you a little bit. My grandpa had dentures and he showed me, I was always fascinated when he would pull his teeth out. So I thought everybody's teeth out. So one night my grandma was laying down and I was leaning over and I'm trying to pull her teeth out. And she's like, what are you doing? So, just something simple and funny as that. And then I used to go to a one with him every Wednesday, and he would take me, and every time before I would go inside, I'd open the center console, pull out his Old Spice aftershave, put him to smell just like him. You know, not only was he a grandpa, but he was a friend, and you know, he was a father figure and a teacher. And I think one of the best things that any of us could do to honor him would be to carry on this wonderful legacy that he's left for us. You know, the loving, caring, compassionate, everything that he's taught us over these years, just try to emulate that as much as possible. I would think that would be the best way.
He gave everyone else 5. I get 10. I just have 2 short stories to share with you. And it has to do with Dick's sense of humor. I met Dick when I was 13 years old. I'm 68 years old now, though I've known Dick for a long time. I met him back when we lived in Lyndhurst, back in the back of our property. We had a big tree and we had built a tree house and we were sleeping out that night. Dick's friends, of course, were older than mine, but I can't even remember how we got together like that. We were making a lot of noise, and my mom and my sister Faith came back and said, you guys better be quiet or they're going to call the cops on you. They no more than walked away, didn't look at his friends, and these are his exact words. I'm going to make time with that broad. Now back then, I did not look at my sister in that context. She was just a royal pain in the neck. I asked Dick one time, I said, Dick, do you remember saying that? And he said, yes, I do. And I said, okay, remembering that, Dick, answer me this. I said, how many times in all the years that you've been married to my sister have you looked in the mirror and said, what the heck were you thinking? The second one is when my daughter was real young, she had had an accident in the bed. She had wet the bed. And when we confronted her on it, She said, "Uncle Dick snuck in my room and wee-weed in my bed." You laugh, but the funny part is, I believed it. You should have seen the look on Dick's face when I confronted him. It was all in good fun, and Dick had a sense of humor, and, well, he had to. I guess to put up with me. I was going to close with a serious note, but I was given something to read by one of Dick's grandsons. I'll try to get through it. It sums up the kind of man that Dick was. The legacy that he left to those of us in the family and the friends that knew him, excuse me. My grandpa, if I could sum up my grandpa in one word, it would be to be a Christian. One word is not enough, though. He had a relationship with Jesus that would carry him into eternity. He loved others, then himself. He thought about others' needs before his own. He was kind-hearted. He was superbly helpful. Even when in pain, his thoughts were on others. He was an awesome father who raised four great kids into adulthood. He helped form the base off of which I was raised. He was an understanding husband. He was a supportive of grandma. He was wonderful with the grandkids and great-grandkids. His work ethic had been nothing short of outstanding. He was my grandpa, and I will love him forever. Thanks for being a marvelous example to me. You will be missed. With love, your grandson Dan. Beautifully, beautifully said. P.S. I am also thankful that I was able to express these feelings, well, through me, to grandpa, in a card I gave him several weeks ago.
Thank you guys for coming. It's nice to see all of you here. And the thing I want to start off with is about, like what Kelly said about going to Awana. Like every time me and Rachel would stay over his house, we would go stay over and eat dinner, and all of us would always fight over which, like, there were these stools that we always had, and then there was the regular chairs. And we would always argue on which person would get the stool, and I don't want to get the chairs. And I'm pretty sure I cried a few times, like, why didn't I even get the stool? During the times when he was sick, I would always go over his house, and the days that he would say, "Oh, do you want something?" Every time I'd get up, I'd be like, "Hey, Poppy, you know, you want, like, go get him something?" And I'd get him something from the freezer. And like Rachel said, like, he he was the happiest person ever. Like, I can only think of a couple times where I've seen him upset about something. I can just never forget what he did for us. Thank you.
I'm just going to talk about three quick things because, as everybody else has alluded to, and as you can tell in the video, the kind of person that my dad was, I just want to say three things that kind of stood out to me about him. First of all, love your wife and support her no matter what. Love your spouse. And the story I'd like to share with is when we were younger, you know, my mom usually was a disciplinarian because she was the one who was home all the time. And Nadine often watched us because she was the oldest. And so we were at home, and I don't know what we fought about, but man, we fought, it seemed like, the whole time my parents were gone. In fact, at one point, I think my sister threw me out of the house. Now, you, all of you that know Nadine, I am not telling you, this is not a lie, this is a true story. She threw me out of the house in my underwear. I probably deserved it somewhat, but anyway. So when my parents got home, of course, we all went running to them. You know, we were all telling them in our own way, in our own story, what happened. Well, since they couldn't decipher who really was at fault, my mom decided that she would spank the two younger ones, so Rick and Joy, and my dad would spank Nadine and I. Well, I tell you to this day, we got the better end of that deal because my dad, that was the only time I ever remember my dad ever spanking me. He just didn't, and I don't think, you know, and I know as I look at my husband, the few times he spanked our kids, he never did it that hard. Where my mom, you know, she had something to prove when she was spanking me. What Joy alluded to also, love life no matter what happens. Love your family, and realize, and I tell my kids all the time, and I've told them this since probably the day they were born, even though they weren't going to remember it that long ago, love your family, because when, excuse me, all hell is breaking loose, your family, they're the people that are there for me, they're the people that were there for me, and you all know our story about my father, and situations like that divide families, they divide people. And my dad was the pillar that stood there. And it leads me into my third point, which is love God. He loved God, and then he loved his family. He served God, as you all know, and as we've alluded to. After Rick was murdered, and we had grown up in the church. In fact, we laughed about how we went to church on Wednesday nights for youth group. We went to church on Sunday mornings, and we went to church on Sunday nights. And the only time you weren't allowed to go to church was if you were laying on your deathbed sick, and you had to prove it. Otherwise, you were getting up, you were putting your dress on, and you were going to church. But that was my dad. So, after Rick was murdered, I struggled for a long time. You know, asking God, like, why him? Why us? I liked the person that I was. No, I didn't want to be a better person. You know, people say, well, you go through things and you become a better person. So I didn't want to be a better person. I thought I was a pretty good person to begin with. So I struggled for a lot of years, and what really led me back to the church and to God was watching my parents, not just my dad, but my mom, watching my parents. Never saying a word, never asking me, why aren't you coming to church? What is going on with you? Don't you know that's where you're supposed to be? You're not sick. Get there. Never said that. They may have thought it, but never said it. It was by their example. It was by his example of what was most important to him that made me realize and made it important to me that when I had children that I raised them. to not only be grateful for what they have, but to be thankful to God for what they have. And that in silence, he was the silent strength. You know, we always want to have all these words to say, but sometimes just silence is okay, and he was the epitome of that. He was the epitome of just being still and quiet. And those last few hours that Nadine talked about, he never, probably the last, what, 12 hours he was alive, he never said two words, but he shuffled to the end of the bed and wanted to get out of bed. We were like, Dad, get back in bed. We didn't think he could even stand. And finally I said, no, let's get him up. He wants to go to his chair, I think, and he sat in that chair. So we got him up. He stood. I instructed Kelly kind of how to get his arm underneath his arm. He actually stood up. He bared weight while we held him under his arms. We sat in the wheelchair. We got him out to his chair. Never said a word then. But he sat in that chair until about 4 or 5 in the morning. And then I said, you know, he was getting pretty restless. I said, let's get him back to bed. And so we did. Yeah, he was trying to get out of the chair at one point. He was really mad at me because I had made it so that he couldn't put the chair forward because I was afraid he'd fall. We would all fall asleep and he would try and get up and fall. But I mean, that's what he was doing in like less than 12 hours of work. That was his strength in his silence. So, church again, going back to that. I used to sing in church. Some of you know that, some of you may not know that. I don't have the best voice in the world. I don't claim to be a professional at it. I sang because when I started going back to church, that was kind of a way for me to express how I felt because I'm not usually this talkative. I sang at my brother's funeral, and I'm going to sing the same song I sang at his funeral today as a tribute to my dad. He always sat the second row at church. And every single time I sang, like I said, it may not have sounded the best, but he always sat there, and he always got a little tear in his eye, and I knew how much that meant to him. That I sang. So that is what I'm about to do now. Thank you.
Thank you. My sermon for today is, I'll be short and sweet. There's so much about Dick I could talk about, but so I'll just share one of my first memories of Dick. He of course, started to date Faith, and Dick's friends were, I don't know, I'll use an old-timey expression, they were greasers. And he always called me Ponch at school, and I was always known as Carl, so I'd always say, don't call me Ponch, call me Carl. And there was some big guy who kept picking on me, and when Dick started to date Faith and hung around some of Dick's associates, he suddenly stopped picking on me. So I was thankful for that. But I'm sure, well, the memory that I'm sure we'll all have of Dick is any time there was something going on, he was there. Where's Dick? He's in the kitchen. He's helping to prepare. He's helping to clean up. And he just, if Dick had the gift of helps, no doubt about it. And it'll be a strange thing now to see him in family activities and not see Dick out there in the kitchen. And in the early days, Dad was not going to be won over. But Dick just, what can I do? Can I help you? Even, we always had gardens. And from the Lindbergh's days on, and Dick would be out there weeding the garden, because frankly, we didn't. Weeding the garden wasn't something we did. But Dick always helped, always wanted to do things, always was there. And I've said this for quite a while. Dick, to say Dick was my brother-in-law really doesn't do him justice. Dick was a second brother. And I'll miss him. I surely will. Thank you.
They've chosen a song called Praise You in the Storm, and this has a lot of significance for the family. So there are lyrics by a group called Casting Crowns. You can follow along, but I didn't show you.
Down and wiped our tears away.
stepped in and saved the day. But once again, I say amen, and it's still raining. But as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain.
This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and, I put in, sisters there. If anyone has material possessions and sees his brother in need but has no pity on him, how can the love of God be in him? Dear children, let us not love with word or tongue, but with actions and truth. Another one is taken from John 15, 12 through 13. My command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he laid down his life for his friends. You know, Dick Whitcomb was the man he was because of the one he served, his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Dick's thankfulness and love for Christ's sacrifice on the cross for his sins, which he personally accepted, motivated and animated his entire life. He faithfully served the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, even through the toughest of trials. As you heard, when his son Rick was murdered, Dick stood faithfully by his Lord, his wife, his daughters, as well as his whole family. As was mentioned, Dick had a quiet yet resilient faith. Dick exhibited many of, if not all of, the qualities listed in 1 Corinthians 13. And as I thought about this, I said, I can read these in good conscience with Dick's name inserted in these. Dick was patient. Dick was calm. Dick did not envy. Dick did not boast, nor was he proud. Dick was not rude or self-seeking. Dick was not easily angered. Dick kept no record of wrongs. Dick did not delight in evil, but rejoiced with the truth. Dick always protected, always trusted, always hoped, and always persevered. And I can say that Dick's love never failed, because the evidence of Dick's love that it did not fail is that his love lives on in his family, his grandchildren, and those people that he touched. Love, servanthood, loyalty, faithfulness, and trustworthy are words that define the life of Dick Whitcomb. Being the pastor of Grace Evangelical for the last 9 years, and I'm sure Pastor Murphy was the recipient of all the graces that Dick did and was, but Dick faithfully served as an elder in the church. One of his specific duties was the office of treasurer. And I want to tell you, you could not find a more faithful and trustworthy man for that office. Dick, as was said, could always be found around the church preparing, cleaning up, always one of the last ones, the first ones there, and the last one to leave. He spent many nights at the City Mission in Cleveland, cooking and serving men off the streets who came in for a good hot meal, and as well as to hear about the love of Jesus Christ. Dick was always repairing something that needed to be repaired around the church. He was reaching out to widows within the church, cutting lawns. Dick was the man to get the job done. And I've been saying since Dick's been home with the Lord, where are the men that are going to be, that are going to fill these type of spots? Not just in our church, but in our society. Men that rose to the occasion and did what needed to be done, whether they felt they were particularly gifted at it or not. So it's a tremendous tribute to him. You know, Dick spent 27 years in the Awana program. Now, mind you, he not only helped run it, but week after week he sat down with little kids and listened to their scripture verses and encouraged them. Go ahead, you can do this. Over and over, week after week. after week with love and calmness, seemingly never to tire in this eternal endeavor that he was partaking in. And you know, if you knew Dick Whitcomb, for any time at all, he never did anything for the accolades of men. That was not his MO. And I have to think of a parable that Jesus told that exemplifies Dick's attitude, his humble attitude in serving. And Jesus said, suppose one of you had a servant plowing or looking after the sheep. Would he say to the servant when he comes from the field, come along now and sit down and eat? Would he not rather say, prepare my supper, get ready and wait on me while I eat and drink? After that, you may eat and drink. Would he thank the servant because he did what he was told to do? So you also, when you have done everything you are told to do, should say, and I could hear Dick saying this, we are unworthy servants, we have only done our duty. Now the flip side of that is Jesus told another parable about servants like Dick, who invested whatever gifts and talents God had given them, not for themselves, but for God's glory and his kingdom. And this is God's response to those faithful servants. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Dick is now in the presence of the Lord, sharing in his Lord and master's happiness. We can't even imagine what that's really like. We try to think about it. But you know, death has the power to separate us from those we love, at least temporarily, for those that are in Christ. But death cannot separate us from the love of Christ. Because for those who believe in Christ, death way is only the doorway into the very presence of God. As Paul writes in 2 Timothy, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Therefore, death does not divide us from God's love, but actually unites us to God and his love for him. Dick is in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ today. And he is reunited with his son, Rick. And so Paul writes to us today, brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep, or to grieve like the rest of them who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's own word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left till the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage each other with these words. You know, on the Sunday before Dick went home to be with the Lord, as we were all gathered around his bed, telling Dick how much he meant to us. And they had done it many times before, but a special time where the presence of God is there and people are just telling Dick how much he meant to them. And at the end of it, we asked Dick what song he'd like to sing. And he remembered Joe Johnston singing Alpha. And so we mustered up a rendition of that and sang. You'll find the words on the back of your bulletin. And if you would like, I'd like you all to stand. And we're going to sing this, okay? And that'll close our service. It's a two-week song. It's a little bit lively, but can you imagine Dick dancing to this right now in the music? Thank you. close in prayer. I know the funeral, I don't know if you want to say anything, but let me close in prayer. Father, we thank you for the life of Dick Whitcomb, Lord God, that it lives on in the people that you love and serve, Lord God. We ask today as we go to the gravesite, Lord God, that this will be a traumatic time, but we also realize that he's already seated with us in your presence. So we just ask for the people to be blessed in Christ's name.
Amen.
Well, we have a gravesite service, and I'm sure you're all ready.